the game from Philly, Pressbox Radio. Phil Perkins and Jim Chet. Let's go.
It's Wednesday, May 26, 2021. Welcome to the Philly Pressbox Radio Roundtable, brought to you tonight by the Irish Rover Station House in Langhorne, PA, and Allstate Insurance in Westchester, PA. I'm Bill Furman. I'll be your host tonight, along with my partner, Jim Chet Chesko. And hey, Chet, the Sixers opened their series with a nice win against the Wizards, with Game 2 starting as we speak. The Phillies have been really struggling in all phases of the game, but they're still very much in the hunt. There's some excitement coming out of the NovaCare complex. That's good. And Phil Mickelson defied Father Time, as Jim Nance said Sunday, by winning a major. Still plenty going on in sports.
Always is, Bill. You know, I'm excited about the 76ers postseason run having started. I'm hoping it's a long run, maybe going well into July. That would be pretty wild. As for the Phils, I'm just hoping they get things figured out by July and that they have some, you know, healthy players by then, because they're a little banged up right now, sooner than July, ideally. And, you know, Bill, Memorial Day weekend is fast approaching. I'm looking forward to that as well.
Oh, yeah. I'm looking forward to it as well. And a lot going on in the sports world. And, hey, Chet, I didn't mention this in the opening, but have you been watching any NHL playoff hockey?
I honestly have not. I don't even know what's going on. I haven't watched one stinking minute of the NHL hockey with the Flyers not playing.
Well, we'll get to this a little bit later. Not in this show, but in another show. But as you watch, and I haven't watched a ton of it, the two series I have watched a little bit of is the Capital series and the Lightning and the Panthers playing the Panthers. And man, I'll tell you what, when you watch these series, it makes you wonder about the Flyers and how far away they might actually be, because these teams are good, they're physical, they're big, and they have good goaltending.
Yeah, I know. It's going to be a long offseason for the Flyers. Hey, do me a favor and talk about the Eagles or whatever. I have to discuss something with our guest and get him straightened out, so I'll be right back.
All right, sounds good. Hey, speaking of the Eagles, we were going to talk about that a little bit later on, but a lot of good news coming out of the NovaCare complex and Nick Sirianni's initial mini camp. A lot of good words coming. Brandon Graham, I think, probably put it best of everyone, where he said that this is like a young Andy Reid camp going on. And I'm going to take that as a good thing, because those players really respect Andy Reid and what he's done. So interesting coming from Sirianni. He seems like he is a real good players coach at this point. And a quote he had, and I happen to have it right in front of me: we had some really good conversations with our players, some of them are team leaders, about the offseason program. I've always believed it's important to have open communication with your team, and has really been helpful for us as a staff to put together an offseason program. You have to like that starting out, whether he's got enough horses to win. It's a real good start, I think, for some positive things over at the NovaCare complex. And the disappointing thing, I guess, from the Eagles standpoint, is it looks like they've come out with two open practices is all there's going to be this spring, getting ready for the season, only two. And it's a shame for us older guys that, even younger too, that got to go to Westchester, got to go to Widener, and got to go to Lehigh and those places. And now you only get one or two practices at the at Lincoln Financial Field. So that's a shame. We're going to talk a lot of Sixers tonight, of course, and our guest Chris Wheeler will be joining us. I guess Chet is trying to take care of some technical issues to get Wheels with us, but we'll certainly be talking Phillies. A lot going on there. Vince Velasquez has stepped it up and looks like, for now, he's your number four starter and has pitched really well. Beautiful game last night. And the bullpen actually did what they were supposed to do. We'll talk to Wheels about that. Bryce Harper being hurt, finally put on the disabled or injured list. That's not good. So we'll see how that works out. What we need is Harper, Realmuto, and DeGregorius back, because it looked like a triple A roster last night, but they were able to pull out a nice 2-0 win. Rhys Hoskins playing well, hitting the ball well, in home runs. That's good. Andrew McCutchen's still struggling. Alex Baum is really struggling. And Odubel Herrera, been a jolt for the team offensively, and they sure need that. And Odubel was in the leadoff spot last night. I know the game just started a few minutes ago in tonight's game. I don't know where Odubel is in the lineup, but he has certainly helped them out in that center field spot. And whether he's the leadoff hitter or not, Andrew McCutchen was certainly struggling in that leadoff spot. So we're going to hit wheels up with all that. Bullpen, good last night. Hector Neres with a nice close. Only get two hits and get a win. Got to do that. Mets playing good ball. What's a little bit misleading, I think, with the Mets, and again, we'll talk to Wheels about this, is the lead looks close. You know, the standings look close, but the Mets have 7 games in hand due to COVID. So, you know, if you win 5 of those games, all of a sudden that game and a half lead becomes 3 or 3.5 games. So, you know, it's not quite as close as it looks. Mets are having good pitching, so we'll see how that plays out. Certainly, we're going to talk Sixers with Chet tonight. Tobias Harris with a fantastic game on Sunday. The big three of Harris, Embiid, and Simmons playing great. But I had to laugh at some of the Philly faithful that, you know, questioning that Tobias only had 2 assists. The man did everything but mop the floor after the game. He was fantastic. So Embiid was great as well. And Ben Simmons, 0-for-6 at the foul line, certainly not good enough. But 15 rebounds and 15 assists in any game is fantastic. And, you know, and fans coming back crushing Simmons as well, because he only scored a handful of points. So
we're going to get into a lot of that whole Ben Simmons talk later on, Bill. But yep. Remember when we had Ray Fosse on, we had some technical issues on his end. We're having trouble getting Chris Wheeler to connect. But let's give this a go. And he's going to be coming through my phone and into my microphone. So, Chris Wheeler, how are you, my man?
I can very vaguely hear him, but he said he's out on his deck on the Gulf of Mexico, I believe.
Yeah, look, that's not a bad deal. All right, let's talk a little Phillies, Chris, first of all. You know, there's so many things we can complain about, but I'm going to actually talk about something very positive right now, and that's the fact that, I can't believe I'm saying this, Vince Velasquez, 4 straight solid outings as a starter. I've been a big critic of Vince's the last couple of years especially, but is it possible that he has finally figured it out? Bill, you got a question for Wheels?
Yeah, hey, first of all, can you put your phone on speakerphone so we can hear? Would that work better? Because we're having a little trouble hearing Wheels. Exactly. Okay. Yeah, but my question for Chris is that fifth spot certainly looks like it's a problem right now. Yep. Do they show some patience with Spencer Howard, let him run out there a handful of times and get better rather than try to move along with, they got rid of Matt Moore. Just trying to fill this in with someone else. Go ahead and give Spencer Howard as many starts as they can.
Yeah, Wheels, Bill wants to know about Spencer Howard. I mean, we saw him the other day. He went just 3 innings, and he was actually, I guess, winded in the 3rd inning. So what is the approach with Spencer Howard now? He's a young guy, and yet, you know, he couldn't go more than 30 pitches. So what do you do about Spencer Howard?
First base, and then he couldn't. His velocity went down 5 miles per hour in the next inning. I don't understand it. He's obviously had a problem in his brief career in that his velocity keeps going down at certain times. It just doesn't seem to work out for him. That he goes past 2 or 3 innings, and all of a sudden his velocity's gone. So that's one of those things they're going to have to figure that out. You know, whether he has a shoulder problem that's going to be ongoing, whether he has some kind of a stamina endurance thing. But I've never heard of anything like that before. Look, I've seen pitchers hit a home run, and then go out there the next inning and be gassed when they get out there because they're so excited, all the emotion of the thing. And you can kind of understand that. Sometimes that can happen. But this seems to be an ongoing thing with him, Bill and Chet, and they're going to have to figure, you know, they're going to have to figure that out with him because, you know, you watch him for an inning and he's electric. Now, of course, right away people say, well, put him in the bullpen, make him the closer. You know how far that is from where he is right now to do something like that? So I don't know what the answer is.
Yeah, I hear you. Well, speaking of pitching, a couple of weeks ago, Chris, we had Brian Michael from Phillies Nation on, and I asked him whether he thought Aaron Nola was a true ace. And kind of surprisingly to me, he said yes. And I should have challenged him on it more because, well, shame on me, but I don't think he is or has been. The last couple of seasons, you know, he faded down the stretch. He's been inconsistent this year. If there's a true number one on this staff, I think it's Zach Wheeler. So settle that debate for us, Wheels.
Well, he is right now. There's no doubt about that, that Zach Wheeler is. You know, I've always been kind of wary of that term, an ace. You know, Aaron Nola, when he was signed by the Phillies, was deemed a guy who was going to be a two or three in the league, starter in the league. And he was also deemed by the organization as a pitcher who probably had a chance to get to the major leagues the fastest because of his experience at LSU and what a great program that was and the big games he pitched in. And I don't know that I'm right, but I think it's pretty close that that's what happened, that he was the first early pitcher of that class to get to the major leagues and pitch effectively in the major leagues. So, you know, to call somebody an ace, how many of them are nowadays that you do that? I think people get involved in some silly arguments sometimes about whether this guy's an ace or that guy's an ace or who cares. What you want is somebody that goes out there and can keep you in games, game after game, pitch six, seven innings. So that's what they expect out of them nowadays. Right now, if you were to look at the best pitcher and you want to call him an ace on the Phillies, it's Zach Wheeler. But sometimes people disparage Aaron Nola's ability. This guy is still a heck of a major league pitcher.
Bill?
Hey Wheels, you know, we always assume when we're talking about the Phillies over the last few years that Bryce Harper is going to get his. As we sit here now, he's injured. He's presently seventh on the team, tied with Brad Miller in runs batted in. And has not looked very good at the plate for most of the season. Reason to be concerned yet?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I'm always concerned when a guy can't play, especially a guy that wants to play as much as this guy does. Now, you don't be concerned that he gets streaky sometimes and he strikes out for a week because he's done that in his career. That's Harper. And then, you know, he gets really, really hot and he can do so many things because he walks so much. But was he in this current funk that he was in? Hey, he's really been in a little bit of a funk since he got hit in the face. And he's not the first guy to go into a funk when they get hit in the face. Now, did that have anything to do with it? They're saying there's something wrong with his arm. I was at the game in Dunedin the night when he had it come out, and he was favoring his shoulder, evidently. Now they're saying there's something wrong with his forearm in the area where he put it up to protect himself when that ball hit him. That's a tough thing to answer. But I think probably they're doing the right thing is let him sit for 10 days, a week to 10 days, get healthy mentally, get healthy physically, and then come back and do what he can do. He's a tremendous player. He's been a tremendous player since he's been with the Phillies, but he's always been streaky. And it would catch him once in a while when you could strike him out six, seven times in a series, and then you catch him where he gets seven hits and four of them would be home runs, something like that. So that's what he is. And to think he's going to change just because you change uniforms, he's the same guy.
Yeah. All right. Getting back to pitching, I want to talk about the bullpen. It's certainly better than last year's dumpster fire, but it's still far from elite also. I do think there are guys there who have a lot of potential to continue to get better. How do you like the makeup of this bullpen?
Well, you just said it's better. And the thing that's disappointing is Kinsler, because I really thought Kinsler was going to be a great bridge to some of the other guys that they have, because that's what he's been his whole career. And he's really been good. He's not the new wave of going out there and throwing 98, striking out the side. He's a put-it-in-play guy. And when you're a put-it-in-play guy out of the bullpen, you don't want them late in the game if you can avoid it. You want to bring them in, to get some ground balls or maybe even to get a double play in the middle of an inning. He's been the most disappointing. The other one's Bradley because he got hurt right away. And since he's come back, his velocity evidently has been down and he hasn't been the same guy. Coonrad's been a pretty good find. He's one of these power guys that can strike a lot of guys out. Alvarado, flip a coin. You don't know who's showing up on a given night. When the good one shows up like last night, oh, man, he's really fun to watch, and he's nasty to hit off. When the bad one shows up, you know, you're glad if you're sitting behind home plate, there's a screen there because he's just all over the place. I saw him flexing his left hand during the game a few times. And I remember I texted Tom McCarthy and those guys. I told him, hey, something's wrong with his left hand. They took him out of the game. And that thing has been bothering him ever since. And I haven't heard any more about Didi with that, you know, whatever is causing his elbow to swell up. And those are three very, very important offensive players. You know, Didi's okay shortstop, but he can hit. Heck, he's hit a lot of grand slams in his career in the last few years. So, to say that, is it important to get him back? You're going to get him back, number one. I hope so. You're going to get him back. And number two, is it important? You bet it's important because those are three, quality major league players who have been through some wars and know how to win.
Hey, Wheels, what do you think? Here we are. We're not even the June 1st yet. We have 8 no-hitters in Major League Baseball. What do you make of all that? I have a theory, but I want to hear yours.
I don't get that. That's, every once in a while you have a fluke or a guy, but one of my best friends in the game a long time ago is a guy named George Culver, is one of our pitching. He played for us and was our pitching instructors and all that. And Georgie pitched a major league no hitter and Steve Carlton didn't. So you go, they're flukes. For me to tell you what's going on right now, that you could have all these no hitters already. And I'm not saying, hey, you're a major league pitcher, you got a chance to do anything. But from guys you never even heard of, and all of a sudden they're going out there throwing no-hitters, there's something wrong with the game offensively to have that happen. And I'm not trying to take anything away from these guys who are throwing no-hitters because it's really hard to do. Obviously, it's hard to do by the numbers that have been pitched in the history of the game. But something's a little funky right now to have this many no-hitters by guys coming out of nowhere and throwing them.
Well, Wheels, that's exactly where I wanted to go in terms of, what's happening with baseball right now and the state of the game. All the no-hitters, strikeouts galore, 9 or more per game, per team. The Phillies won last night with a whopping 2 hits. Thankfully, they got the Rhys Hoskins home run. As of yesterday, the average overall batting average for Major League Baseball was .237. So what the heck is going on, Wheels?
Well, there's a lot of theories on it, Chet, and obviously the number one being that the pitching's so much better, and it is. Yeah. Look, when I was doing the games, if somebody threw 92 or 3, that was really hard. Somebody threw 95, come on. You're throwing 95, and now they throw 98 for the whole inning. They're out there. There's just something about whatever's happened with the pitchers, what they've been able to do with them, to increase their velocity and also to increase, and they keep talking about their spin rate, and there's something to it, whether it's from foreign substances on the ball or whether they've somehow come up with all these kinetics and all this stuff where they're teaching pitchers to spin the ball. To spin the ball effectively, you used to have to be a Steve Carlton to be able to spin the ball so hard that it looked like a fastball coming out of your hand, but it was a slider, and then it was too late to adjust to it. The normal pitcher could not spin a breaking ball that way or spin his fastball to do the kind of things that they're doing right now. So there has to be something to that. The other thing I hate, and I hated it from day one, of the shifts. I understand why you would do it, and you're crazy if you don't do it, because if guys are going to hit into shifts all the time, and then you get the thing, we'll have them bunt. You don't have big power hitters, but that's what the opposition wants you to do. They want you to bunt and then put some big slow guy on first base that takes 2 hits to score them. That's what they want. But these shifts, I just hope somehow, some way, that they're able to do something about these shifts and eliminate them, because I think that would bring more offense back to baseball, even with this pitching the way that it is right now. And sooner or later, they're going to have to have a study on the pitching and why these guys can throw so much hard, so many guys can throw so much harder and spin the ball the way they're able to do right now that they couldn't do before, because something's up with that.
Bill?
Well, yeah, to follow up on that, Chet, what I'd like to throw at Wheels is my theory has 3 points to it. One is he already hit on. Everybody that used to throw low 90s now throws high 90s. Yep. That's one. Two is that the strike zone, they are now calling the high strikes that they weren't calling before. And the third point is this home run or bust uppercut swing that us old timers hate can't hit that high pitch. So now we're striking out all the time. Those are my 3 points to why I feel like pitching is dominating the game.
Well, in every other sport, in football, they show all the touchdowns and the celebrations in the end zones. You know, the guys that score touchdowns. You know, in basketball, it's everybody pointing at each other because they hit a shot from 40 feet away. You know, every sport has changed so much in our lifetimes, and our sport has changed, unfortunately, with this uppercut that came in to try and hit the ball out of the ballpark, and they had the balls are probably a little bit juiced there for a while, so they got a lot more home runs with this uppercut swing. And what that does is cause guys to swing and miss a lot. And you're talking about high strikes. Well, yeah, that's another thing where you could, you know, make them bring the ball down a little bit in the strike zone, and not because pitchers are recognizing what's happening, and they're going to throw the ball up in the letters areas because these guys are going to swing at them because they're trying to uppercut all the time. Well, when you're trying to swing at that pitch, you can't hit that ball in the ballpark that often. So, yeah, there's a whole different hitting philosophy right now that has come into the game. And, you know, whether or not you can legislate things through balls and strikes, you have to start that stuff a lot earlier. You know, guys are used to things by the time they get to the big leagues. The other thing that we've haven't talked about is the out in baseball. I hear it all the time. Why don't they sacrifice? Why don't they hit the other way? Because the analytics have now convinced every organization that an out, you waste an out when you do those kind of things, and you only get 3 per inning and 27 per game. So you don't waste outs. So that's why you don't see sacrificing. That's why you don't see guys give themselves up and hit the ball the other way. And it does nothing to affect their salaries. At one time you say, well, you know, guys getting hurt by giving himself up with an at-bat, not anymore. And if I hear one more person in our sport say that a strikeout is just an out, I just want to scream because it's so untrue. You have a bad defensive team like the Phillies.
Yeah.
You want to put the ball in play against the Phillies as much as you can because someone may make a mistake. And the other way with the Phillies against a poor defensive team, put the ball in play. Maybe somebody makes a mistake. I hate that when I hear that. And it's the one thing that just makes me want to just scream when I hear it.
Boy, you got a big smile and a thumbs up from Bill Furman on that one because, yeah, he agrees with you totally on that front. Wheels, I know we talked in the past with you about Dick Allen. I'm actually wearing my Dick Allen Belongs in the Hall of Fame t-shirt right now. I'm hopeful that he will finally get the call into the hall this December, but it's just really sad to me that he won't be there for that induction when it does happen because, of course, we lost him this past December, and that's just a shame.
Oh, amen to that. I've always been a proponent of him because I was lucky enough to not only see him as a fan when I was mesmerized by Richie Allen in those days and the things that he could do at Connie Mack Stadium for us kids that would go to the games, but also by the Dick Allen that I got to know when he was a player for us. And then I worked in the organization. I had so many wonderful conversations with him about baseball because Chet, Bill, he loved to talk the game. He had an unbelievable mind and memory for things that happened with him as a player. So, and then you analyze his numbers and what he did against the greats in that era. And the thing that still bugs the heck out of me is when I hear this thing from these people that speak up against him. I have no clue that he was a bad guy in the clubhouse. So untrue. And if any, half that team wanted to punch Frank Thomas in the mouth, and he was the only one that finally did it. I know that from knowing those guys later on that told me about how the things that Frank Thomas was saying to Dick back in those days, they look back on it and said, we should have taken care of that and not made him do it himself. And then, you know, he got ostracized during some tough Rachel times in Philadelphia that they sided with Frank Thomas. So all those things factored against him. You'll never hear players that played with him say he was a bad teammate ever.
Wheels, it's almost June. You're still in Florida. How's your golf game?
Oh, it's pretty good right now for me. I just want to, I got to tell you, I just came back from 2.5 days, 3 days over in Port St. Lucie with a couple of high school buddies of mine that have been trying to get me to come over there. They've retired and living over in that area on the East Coast. I wanted to play golf, and one of them was a really, really good player at one time. And he says, you know, he's come back to the pack, but he couldn't wait to get me over there and get me. Well, I got him. So it was really fun. Hey, I'm a 15 index, and I play to it, and I really enjoy the sport a lot. 75, I'll be 76 this year. You hit it out there in the fairway a decent distance and make some shots and get up and down, and you can really enjoy it. But it's a sport for a lifetime, and I love it.
Chris, I have one final question for you. We never actually brought this up on our show with you, but can you tell our viewers and listeners how you made your broadcast booth debut back in 1976?
It's an unbelievable story, and it's true. So we're playing the Montreal Expos in 1976 in September in a doubleheader. So we win the first game. The Phillies are champions. At that time, it was just the East, and you would go on to play the West and then see who went to the World Series. So If you win the first game of the doubleheader, we win our first championship since 1950. We win the first game of the doubleheader. Between games, you have the stuff that you see. It was the same. Champagne, all this stuff spraying all over the place. Well, you got to do another game. It's never been done before. It hasn't happened since. So we go up to do the game and, get dried off. And Harry and Whitey tried to avoid as much of that as they could because they still had to stay in their dress clothes and all that. I could care less. I got all soaked and everything. So I go up there and about second or third, fourth inning, I can't remember what it was. I'd always hung out in the booth with those guys because I love the broadcasting part of it. And I walk in, and Whitey says, here comes that Chris Wheeler. He's a guy that screws up all the newsy notes, makes us sound bad. He'd do that old shtick on me like I was some idiot. But he's always wanted to be on the air. Well, why don't we do it right now? Chad Bill, he gets up, he takes the headset off, and I sit down, and I think, you got to be kidding me. Well, I'm thinking, I'm never doing this again. I'm going to have the time of my life. So I get to do a couple innings with the great Harry, and I'm having some fun talking about this, that, and the other thing that I would do later on for 37 years. Unbeknownst to me, our broadcast is going into a box next door where John McHale, the president of the Expos, is sitting with Bill Giles. And John says, Bill, who's that broadcaster of yours? And Bill says, John, he's one of our PR guys, and I have no idea what the hell he's doing. And John McHale, because he and I talked about it many times, John McHale said to Bill, Bill, he's pretty good. He really knows the game. And Bill says, he does. Well, that year in 76, Bison had retired. Andy Musser was doing the games alone on radio when the other two guys were on television. They figured they needed some guy to work with him the next year when the games were televised. Giles said to himself, hey, I got wheels here. I don't have to pay him any more money. He goes on every road trip. What the heck? Let's throw him the hell in there and see what happens. 37 years later, I was still doing it. I always say, guys, if we'd have lost the first game of the doubleheader, I don't know that I'd ever been able to have that opportunity.
Wow. What a great story. Chris, this was a blast. Sorry about the technical issue. Sorry, I'm not smart enough to figure out how we could have made it better. But anyway, thanks for joining us, and I hope to see you sometime at the ballpark this summer.
All right. Thanks, Wheels.
See ya.
All right. Hey, Chet, good stuff. We got through it there. Oh, maybe.
Wait, now I'm tangled up.
Yeah.
Yes, we figured it out.
We got through it. You muted. You went mute for a while on us. You know that.
I know.
you got through it. Wheels is good stuff.
That was a great story, wasn't it?
Yes, it was. All right. Hey, Chet, if your couch is getting more mileage than you are, I believe it probably is, than your car, it's time to start saving with Allstate's pay-as-you-go auto insurance.
Yes, indeed, Bill. Allstate's pay-as-you-go auto insurance puts you in control. You only pay for the miles you drive with the same full coverage that a traditional policy offers. Pay-per-mile insurance gives customers greater control of their insurance costs. See how much you can save with pay-per-mile car insurance by calling your local agent. In Westchester, Pennsylvania, that, of course, is Dave Lavoie. Call Dave at 610-430-0700. Once again, the number 610-430-0700. 800-700 and start to save more now that you are driving less. And now, Bill, the guy whom I'll be seeing this Saturday night at the Ardmore Music Hall, that, of course, the great Willie Nile.
Hey, everybody, it's Willie Nile here, and you're listening to Chet and Bill on Philly Pressbox Radio. You lucky people.
And you know, Bill, I mentioned Willie this Saturday, and there he is. A few tickets do remain for Willie Nile's Saturday night show at the Ardmore Music Hall. And that's a great little place. I've only been there, I think, twice in my life. The last time was about 2 years ago. So looking forward to seeing good old Willie this Saturday night.
Good stuff. Hey, Chet, one more point on the Phillies and seeing old friends. It's good to hear Dan Baker back in the box in the games or back in the booth. And the game's back at Citizens Bank Park. Have you noticed that Dan is back?
Oh, yeah, I noticed that he's back. And, you know, he does a show most Mondays with Greg Luzinski, the Bull. They call it Bull Session, yeah. And they have guests each week. And I try to watch it actually while I'm doing my work. So it's good to see Dan. Good to hear him back in the booth, especially when, you know, they're doing the games from Citizens Bank Park. You know that voice all the time.
Absolutely. Good stuff. Hey, Chet, we talked about the Sixers a little bit while you were gone. Big three was great on Sunday. Tobias Harris leading the way. A great game from Embiid. Great game from Simmons. But the Philadelphia faithful, dogging Ben Simmons, dogging Tobias Harris a little bit about having only two assists. What is going on with all that? And tonight, Sixers look like they're off to a pretty nice start.
Yeah, I don't know what's going on tonight, but I know the other night. I think that the Tobias thing had to be a joke. The guy scored 37 points, 28 in the first half, and he carried them. As for Ben Simmons, he is just one of these guys who's going to have people who love him and people who hate him, kind of like, you know, Donovan McNabb and some of the other stars we've had in Philly. Ben had 15 points or 15 assists and 15 rebounds, but only 6 points. So people are, you know, all over him for that. They want him to be a complete player. They want him to take jump shots. As you noted, he was 0-for-6 from the foul line, and that is unacceptable. A guy's got to be able to shoot free throws. And he had been doing a lot better during the season. Then he kind of trailed off at the end, and he was dreadful on that end of things the other day. So he's got to get better in that, and I want to see more aggressive.
You didn't mention his defense.
The defense is always great.
Right.
Always great. So, yeah, but people are never going to be totally satisfied with Ben Simmons. And if they win a title, I think they'll forgive him.
Well, I tell you what, if he'd had 15 points to go with those 15 rebounds, 15 assists, a great defense, I'm not sure that would still have been enough.
Oh, yeah. Even the times he gets a triple-double, people will say, yeah, but it was only 11 points. So that's not really a true triple-double. It is, but I get the point.
Right. 35-24 Sixers at the end of one.
Okay, I think they were favored by like 8.5 tonight, and I think they'll win it. I think they're going to lose game three down in Landover, but win the series in five. That's my prediction.
Yeah. What'd you think about the decision to bring Pat Krejci back to ring the bell tonight? That was a cool choice.
I wish I would have seen it. He's been all over the place lately, back in the area, I guess. He did one of those tell us your story things with Glenn and Ray a couple of weeks back. They had him on WIP again today. He was on with Mike Missinelli on 97.5 a week or so back. So he's been making the rounds. And, yeah, I got to see the highlight of that because he promised he was going to maybe put another crack in that bell when he hit it tonight. So what a great guy, just so positive. And, you know, he's got the memories from 20 years ago with the run with AI, and great to see him back in town.
Yeah. So let's jump back to Sunday's game and Tobias Harris. Were you surprised that not that he played so well, but that he kind of took the lead in that game?
A little bit. Yeah. You don't expect that, but you got to remember, Simmons is just not a guy who's going to do it. And Embiid got an early foul trouble, a couple of early fouls, three fouls in the first half. They weren't necessarily great calls by the refs, but so somebody had to take charge. And Tobias can do that. And as we've noted previously, he has played much better under Doc Rivers than he did under Brett Brown. So it's good to see, and I like Tobias. I think he's a good guy, and he can definitely step up his game on occasion, and he did it Sunday, and they needed him.
Hey, how about an update for you since we're talking Ben Simmons and Tobias Harris? First quarter stats, Ben Simmons, 12 points, 5 rebounds, 1 assist.
Whoa!
Tobias, 8 points, 1 rebound, and Embiid just 2 and 2.
12 points for Simmons in the first quarter. Is that a misprint?
6 for 8 from the field, 12 points, 5 rebounds in 9 minutes.
We got to end the show now, Bill. I got to go watch basketball.
He might not get 12 points the rest of the game, but he gets 12 points
care.
In the first. Hey, it's
I don't
good.
Care. As long it's as they good. Win.
Yeah, we'll see how it goes. All right. This is a big game, I think. They go up 2-0. This series is where you want it to be.
Yeah, I'm not too worried about this series. I think they'll win this one in 5. Like I said, I think they'll win the next one against either the Knicks or Hawks in 5 also. So it'll get tougher after that if they play the Nets or Bucks, of course.
Absolutely. All right, Chet, let's give a shout-out to all the shows over at the Edge of Philly Sports Network, which we are part of. Bird's IQ every Monday, 7 p.m. with Kyle and Eric Quinn talking Eagles football. Edge of Philly Sports Live with Joe, Freddie, Big Al. They cover 4 for 4 and so much more Philly sports. That's live tonight, every Wednesday, 9:30 p.m. Eastern Time. Check that out. Join Tom Kelly and the gang at Patterson Avenue Fanatics Saturday mornings at 9 a.m. They, too, talking all things Philly sports. And, Chet, we didn't get to see it because we were getting ready for our show, but our man Freddie did a Sixers preview, pregame preview tonight at 6:30, and I believe they're going to be doing more of that. That was a pretty good setup, so that would be pretty good.
Yeah, Freddie and Paul Spencer, one of the newcomers to EOP, did the show. He's a good guy, and I know Freddie loves talking basketball. The Sixers is a huge fan, so I'm sure they killed it.
Yep. Well, you can check out all the shows at www.eopsports.com. Help us out by hitting those subscribe, follow, and like buttons, and as always, share with your friends and family. Don't forget to sign up for the weekly EOP newsletter that arrives each Friday by email. And check, I believe we were video of the week last week or something.
Wow, we must have done something right. It's like being employee of the week at Wendy's, I guess. You know, it's a nice honor. Did you hear a bell?
I think I did. Is it random chat time?
It is, and I tell you, after all the technical difficulties, I needed a brewski, so I'm good. Let's talk a little music yet again, Bill. You heard the bell, and so, yeah, we got to do it. No. Here we go. Yes, indeed. It's springtime, Bill, and I do like spring, but I got to tell you, even though it can get hot, very hot, I love summer. Baseball, the pool, the beach, bikinis, hey, why not? And, you know, hanging outside by the pool with a frosty beverage or two and some great summer music. Speaking of summer music, well, believe it or not, there are some 300 songs with summer or summertime in the title. Trust me, I ran analytics on that. Yeah, there are some decent ones like this one from Elvis Costello. There are some dreadful ones, too. For example, the Beach Boys' Summer of Love. I can't wait till summer, 'cause it's gonna be a summer of love. Hey, now. Well, it's a love thing. Yikes. I somehow did manage to pick 45 listenable summer songs. Some you may know, many you probably don't, as far as those on the honorable mention portion of a list. You can see here in the video, 15 honorable mention tunes with summer or summertime. And then 20 more that I ranked numbers 11 through 30. Lots of real good ones, but not quite wonderful enough to make my top 10. Here's what I do consider to be the absolute cream of the crop in terms of songs with summer or summertime in the title. Number 10 is an underrated 1968 gem from Johnny Rivers called Summer Rain. At number 9, then, a fun tune from 1970 by the band Mungo Jerry that I still love to this day. In the summertime, when the weather is hot, you can stretch right up and touch the sky. When the weather's fine, you got women on your mind. Seals and Crofts' early 70s hit Summer Breeze comes in at number 8. Then Don Henley holds down number 7 with The Boys of Summer. 6th, The Summer of 69 by Brian Adams. What a great song that is. All right, the top 5. And first up is the most recent song on this list in terms of, you know, my favorites. It's a big 2008 hit by Kid Rock called All Summer Long, which borrows from both Sweet Home Alabama and Werewolves of London. Sipping whiskey out the bottle, not thinking about tomorrow. Singing Sweet Home Alabama all summer long. Number four, Old Blue Eyes, Frank Sinatra, the classic Summer Wind. You know that had to be high on the list, right? Number three, the great Sly and the Family Stone smash, Hot Fun in the Summertime. All right, there are great versions of summertime blues out there, a lot of them by a lot of different artists, but the very best, if you ask me, is the one by The Who from Live at Leeds, and that one sits at number two, Summertime Blues. And finally, the number one summer song, in this guy's humble opinion anyway, a classic that came out 55 years ago this summer by A Lovin' Spoonful.
Hot town, summer in the city, back of my neck getting dirt and gritty. Bend down, isn't it a pity? Doesn't seem to be a shadow in the city.
And there you have it, Bill. So as I put up a graphic of my top 10, how does my list look to you? What do you think?
Oh, I kind of like it. A couple things that came to my mind until you got that 11 Spoonful there was Mungo Jerry's Sideburns. But 11 Spoonful had the same. I guess that was a thing that I forgot. Probably a good thing I forgot. And where else do you get a list, Chet, but Philly Pressbox Radio that goes from Kid Rock to Frank Sinatra in just a breath?
Yeah, there's a lot of summer songs, man, and it's all inclusive. A lot of great artists on there of all types.
Yeah, good list. Good fun stuff. All good music too.
All right, thank
those
you.
Those were the days, weren't they?
Yeah. I love summer tunes.
That's right. All right. Hey, Chet, we talked a few minutes while you were gone about the Eagles and Nick Sirianni's camp and how things, some good news coming out of the NovaCare complex. But the one thing I didn't mention, I was kind of saving it for you, Howie Roseman keeps adding pieces. We don't know what kind of pieces these are going to turn out being, but he's picking up free agents, guys that were somewhat high draft picks back when they were picked. What do you make of the tinkering being done by Howie Roseman at this point?
Well, it's just that. It's tinkering. We don't know, you know, if any of these guys are going to make a huge difference. It's, depth guys for the defensive line. It's, you know, second string cornerbacks. I still have a lot of issues about the secondary. It's all going to come down to, you know, guys staying healthy, especially on the offensive line, and finding, you know, one or two DBs who can actually play. Darius Slay is back there, and he didn't even have a great year in his first year with the Eagles. So they got some concerns back there. I still don't get why there's so much optimism about the Eagles from some fans and even a lot of media people, as we discussed last week. I just don't get it. Did you mention Brandon Graham at the top, how he's comparing it to the Andy Reid thing?
Yes, we did.
Yep. I don't know. I don't see it. And speaking of Brandon Graham, is it true that he's the second longest tenured athlete in Philly now behind Claude Giroux?
Yeah, I believe so.
Yeah, that would make sense. And then, yeah, he came in 2010, and then Kelsey was a year later. So,
right. Yeah, because he was, when I did that list of guys that were here when we started.
Yeah.
Yeah, Brandon Graham was certainly on that list, along with Fletcher Cox and Zach Ertz and Lane Johnson and Kelsey. So, yeah, Graham is the senior guy.
And speaking of Zach Ertz, we still wait to see what happens to Zach.
Yeah. Well, it's going to be interesting. And again, Chet, I think the funny thing, because I'm on the fickle Philly fans here this week, with Tobias and Ben Simmons dogging those guys, we're getting now Howie Roseman is all of a sudden a genius again with the draft, because the fans love the draft and Howie we trust. We're tinkering, we're making all these great moves. Everything he does, he can sign you and the fans would think it was good. That'll all change a little bit later, I'm sure, but fickle fans we have here, and that's why there's optimism, I feel like.
Yeah, I'm not ready to return Howie to genius status just yet. I'm going to have to see how they actually look on the field this fall.
Might need another Lombardi, you think?
Or at least a playoff contender.
That's right. All right, hey, Chet, great guest tonight, as always, in Chris Wheeler. I wish we could have got a little better audio on him, but it's all good. Who do we have coming next week to Philly Press Box Radio?
You know what's funny? I added some things to our little brand thingamabob, and I'm not seeing now, so I don't know. But I do know who the guest is, so that's the good thing. Hopefully the Sixers by next Wednesday will have swept out the Wizards. It may go five, and if so, they'll be playing next Wednesday night. And if that is the case, I may have to pre-tape this interview because we got a guest with the guy who's going to talk about everything there is to talk about with the 76ers and the Eagles. He's one of our favorite guys, but we haven't had him on the show since June of last year, believe it or not. So it's just about a full year. And that, of course, is Tom Moore, our old pal from Calkins Media and the Bucks County Courier Times and whatever it's called these days. So Tom Moore joining us to talk about all things Philly sports.
Tom is always good because he does talk all things. We can go all over the map with him. That's good.
So if the Sixers sweep, he'll probably be live with us Wednesday, but if they're playing Wednesday night, he'll likely have to pre-tape on Tuesday night, but we'll have Tom Moore either way.
Sounds good. Hey, Chet, we mentioned Phil Mickelson in the Open. He became the oldest player to win a Masters or a major at the age of 50 on Sunday, dominating fashion. And Chet, NASCAR. Yes, I said NASCAR on Philly Press Box Radio. Kid Rock, Frank Sinatra, Love and Spoonful, NASCAR, all on Philly Press Box Radio tonight. They ran a road race in Austin, Texas for the first time, Chet, in a rainstorm. Did you watch either one of these events?
I got to be honest, I knew nothing about the NASCAR event, so I didn't watch it. I somehow completely missed it. Sorry, Denny. Now for Phil Mickelson, I just wanted to mention, I wanted to watch the final round on Sunday, but I had a lot going on. I didn't get to see it. I actually turned on CBS right as they were signing off at like 7:20 or whatever on Sunday night. But I was happy for Phil. I'm sure CBS is pretty happy too, because they peaked at around 13 million viewers during the last half hour or so of the event. They averaged 6.6 million for the final round. And that gave CBS its most highly rated day of golf in 3 years. So the network's happy, and I'm sorry I missed it.
Yeah, it was good. And a nice tweet from Tiger Woods of congratulations to Phil Mickelson. That's cool. And Jim Nantz, you know, he came up with one of those iconic, however broadcasters that do games come up with them, and about Phil outlasted Father Time just as the ball dropped in the cup.
That's nice. Yeah, I'm happy for Phil. That's six majors for him, and you don't expect to do that after age, you know, 45, 46, 48, but he did it at age 50.
He did. Good stuff. And speaking of the NASCAR, because I have to say this because I watched a little bit of it, it was kind of cool, Chet. It was a road race course. It was pouring rain. They actually had a windshield wiper, one single wiper, on the NASCAR cars, and the cars were hydroplaning all over the place. It was eventful, to say the least. It was pretty cool.
I did watch the American Idol finale on Sunday night. I'm not ashamed to admit that.
You should be. and I have to say, unless you're going to get to it, I am disappointed that you missed a birthday today, my friend.
Oh, I didn't miss it, Bill. We'll get to that.
All right. Well, let's give a shout out to our friends over at the PPCC 118 Raz Room. They post great sports memorabilia on their Facebook page for people to take a chance to win something they may not be able to afford or have access to. All items come with certificates of authenticity. They continue to run out great autographed memorabilia from all the Philly teams and more. They have 11 line razzes, mystery boxes, and a memorabilia shop. Check out their Facebook page. Like them or follow them. It's PPCC 118 Raz Room and PPCC 118 Raz Room Shop on Facebook. Well, Chet.
Yeah, Bill, you know, before we get to that, let me just say something here. I got to tell you, I used to have dreams about a pretty young woman on the edge of 17. Yeah, she was young, but she was also a lady. She was a gold dust woman. She was a nightbird who wore leather and lace. I approached her, but she said, "Stand back. Beware the landslide." Was her name Sarah? Was it Rhiannon? No. This white winged dove's name was, in fact, Stevie Nicks. And yes, Stevie Nicks is still beautiful, and she is 73 today. So happy birthday, Stevie Nicks. I didn't forget.
The Black Magic Woman.
Yeah, I did not forget Stevie Nicks' birthday.
Hey, I did see a, as I look back here, see if I can find this real quick, Chet. There was a comment that was made that I wanted to share with you. Here you go. We have one of our viewers left this for you, Mr. Chesko.
No, I would not. I mean, if they're going to sing to me, maybe I'd take Stevie. But no, she's no Kate Beckinsale otherwise. Sorry.
Well, Big John, now you know. Now you know. All right, Chet. You have a parting shot tonight, or was that it?
I don't have a parting shot, just some other random things we didn't get to. Wayne Gretzky going to be a studio analyst doing hockey on the new TNT hockey coverage, so that'll be interesting. Joe West with a milestone. He is now the busiest, most prolific umpire. I don't know what you call it, but he's umpired more games than anybody. Cowboy Joe West, he's been around forever. Speaking of guys who have been around forever, Bob Dylan turned 80 the other day. I was never a huge fan, but I got to give the guy props. He wrote some amazing tunes, especially back in the 60s, that people still enjoy and listen to today. And another guy who's been around forever, I can't believe he's going to finally hang up the microphone, and that is Marv Albert, who's calling it quits after this year's NBA postseason. So, Marv, all the best.
Yeah, good stuff. And I think John Roberts sent another note and said today was Brent Musburger's birthday today as well.
I did not know that. Another legendary broadcaster.
Yeah, yeah. Well, good stuff, Chet.
One other question for you, Bill. Yeah. I know you're probably excited about this, but I got to ask, are you going to watch on HBO Max the big Friends reunion that debuts tomorrow on HBO Max? Friends, they recorded it about 2 weeks ago, the original six cast members. No.
Was it going to be like an interview thing? Just so
yeah, it's mostly an interview thing, and I think they're going to like reenact some scenes and have clips from guests and stuff. I don't know what it's all about, but it's going to be interesting, and it's going to be big numbers for HBO Max. And, of course, I'll be watching.
Yeah, I wouldn't have any problem watching that if I'm okay. Sitting around with, you know, no ball. Yeah,
it's on that. Whenever. You don't even have to watch it at a specific time. It's going to be there, you know, for weeks and weeks and months.
Yeah, I'll be okay with that. I'm not going to set my clock or anything. But
I mean, hey, Jennifer Aniston still looks pretty darn good. Let's just say that.
Yeah, but it's okay.
That's all I got. Wrap it up, Bill.
All right, let's wrap it up. Let's thank our sponsors, our special guest, Chris Wheeler, and our sponsors, the Irish Rover Station House, Bob Sullivan's LikeYourAge.com, PPCC 118 Raz Room, and Dave LaVoy of Allstate Insurance in Westchester. For Jim Chesko, this is Bill Furman. We hope you enjoyed the show. We'll join Philly Press Box Radio next Wednesday, June, Chet. June 2nd already. And it will be after Memorial Day, so you will probably have a few cocktail stories to tell next Wednesday. So yes, join us indeed. For that at 7 p.m. on June 2nd. You can see us live on Facebook or listen to our website, PhillyPressBoxRadio.com, on blogtalkradio.com/PhillyPressBoxRadio, on Google Podcasts, Apple Podcasts, iHeartRadio, and all the others. So high hopes, Philadelphia sports fans, and go Sixers. By the way, Chet. Sixers up 6.
Interesting.
6:13 to go in the second. Ben Simmons, 14 points, 5 rebounds.
Oh, Sixers.